God's love over rebellious you.
I tried to do a little something, but I said I like colors, so The person who made this jersey when I bought it made some more money. What I'm here to say is there's a power that we have as young people. And if we don't realize and understand that power, it will be easily given up and used for the wrong thing. Understand this, everybody that God called to do extraordinary things in the Bible, they were young. David wasn't 35 when he killed Goliath. He was a teenager. Joseph, all these great people, Jeremiah, they were all young. And Jeremiah especially, he went to God and said, God, you want me to do all these great things, but I'm young. How can I do these things? I'm young. God said, you know what? Don't worry about your age. Let no one despise your youth, because with comes youth comes the power of influence. Young people, I'm here to tell y'all, we have the power of influence. The power of influence is so strong, but I feel like we've given that up to the wrong things. And I'm here tonight to say, the moment you say Jesus, the moment you say Jesus is dope. The moment you say Jesus is the most amazing thing ever since sliced bread, since color TV. That is the moment where Jesus can begin to take back his rightful place in society. Take. It starts with you. It starts with you taking back. Watch this. Your identity. A lot of us as young people, we go through an identity crisis. You know, we want to fit in, so we'll choose to conform our identities. Especially us who say, well, I don't know my identity. I don't know who I am. Anybody ever been there? I'm just the only one that's cool. I'm good. I know who I am now. I'm sorry. But I used to be at a place where I said, you know what, honestly, Jesus, people telling me to be this, people telling me to be that, people saying I'm anointed, people saying I'm appointed, other people saying I'm this and that. I don't know who I am. And I'm bold enough and honest enough to say it. Young people, we go through things and we've developed this guard, this mask that says, under no circumstance are we supposed to show anything that we don't know. That's why when our parents get into it with us, we'll act like we know it, but we really don't know it. Parents, can y'all? We'll act like we know everything. No, mama, that's how you do it. No, this is how you do it. Had a situation like that on the way. My mom was saying, no, we are going the wrong way. And I said, no, mom, I've been here before. I know what I'm talking about. I got the GPS. You just drive. And guess what ended up happening? We ended up going the wrong way. We ended up in the back of the hotel building. I thought we was going to the front. But that's because I thought I knew everything. I didn't know how to put that pride down and say, you know what, mama, I really don't know. Let's ask Siri. I don't know. But I felt like I would be losing and control I thought I had. So I did everything I could in that moment to keep a control. Here's the thing, young people. There's things we don't know in life, but because we don't want to show that we don't know it, because we think once we expose what we don't know, we think that relinquishes us from whatever control we think we have over our lives. So we said, you know what? I'll stay with him because I don't want him to know that I don't know if he the one. But I got some kind of control over him, so I'm going to stay with him. Because if I tell him that he ain't the one because I don't know, then he might break up with me. Well, fellas, you know, I mean, I don't know if she, you know, all the homies say that they know her, but I don't know, but, you know, but she cute, though. I don't know if she the one. She always asking me for lunch money. But she cute. I don't know if she the one, but she cute. But if I let her know that I don't know, then she might go. So, but here's the thing. When you came back, when, here's how you, somebody say, take it.
Back.
I messed y'all up right there. Here we go. Take back our identity. How do we take it back? And for those of you who don't know your identity, how do you get it? You go to the one that created you. Here's the thing. You wouldn't take a Lamborghini to a Kia lot for it to be fixed. You wouldn't take a Rolls Royce to a Ford company and expect them to tell you what's wrong with your Rolls Royce. Why did I say those cars? Because to God, you are most more precious. You are more intricate than me. And for us as young people, we run to the wrong manufacturer for our identity. We go to many other manufacturers. We go to the weed. We go to the drink. We go to the club. And we go there for our identities. But how can somebody who is just as broken as you, who doesn't know who they are either, give you back identity? How can a situation with someone or something that causes you to go further, deeper into not knowing who you are, bring you to a place of knowing who you are? Somebody say escape.
Escape.
In the mind of us young people, going to the party, smoking, drinking is our way of escaping. Don't worry, I used to say it too. I'm not standing up here bashing or dimension those who may be walking through that, because I've walked through it too. We here at Crunk Fest tonight, we gonna be very real. Because if I don't tell you how real my situations were, you won't be able to see how real my God is. So I'm standing here today saying, no, I really didn't know who I was. I really let go of some things. I really gave up on life at one point. I really did these things. I really got heartbroken. I really put blades to my arms thinking that that would keep my mind off of the internal pain. I really did these things, but I really had an encounter with God. I really had to cry out to Him. No mic, no lights, no choir, no band in my room. Had to cry out to Him. That's why I'm not afraid or ashamed to do it in public, because I do it in private. Because He's that real. He's that real. Take. In 1 John 5:18, a lot of us, matter of fact, let's go to Matthew 11:12. The scripture is very familiar to a lot of us. And it says, the violent taketh by force. The violent taketh by force. It says, the kingdom of God suffereth much, but the violent taketh for us. Example. Come here, Junior. Give you a quick example. Let me show you what happens when you know who you are. It's mine. Thank you for the phone. I needed a new phone. It's what? No, it's mine. It's not yours. You know it's not yours. How y'all know it's not his? He don't believe it's his. It's not his. I took it. He don't want it. It's mine. Clearly it's mine. No. What you doing? That's my phone. How you know it's your phone? Because you know what your phone look like. That's not enough for me. What you mean? A lot of Christians know what the church look like. How you know that's your phone? How you know that's your phone? You really know. I'm not asking him trick questions. You know the answer. How do you know that's your phone? Think. What makes it yours? It's not a trick question. What makes it your phone? like, why you, why, what makes it tough? Okay, just give me one. Okay. The most important thing that makes it yours. Your identity in it, what else? Something else. Something you do every month. The bill that you pay for. Okay. Y'all make some noise for the mic. Okay. So, just what happens in our life on a daily basis. God has given us something. God has paid for us. But we have allowed things to come in and take what God has given us, lay it down wherever they see fit, and tell you that it's not yours. And make you think that it's not yours because it was taken from you, or because you gave it up does not mean it's no longer yours. See, once you realize that something is yours, you will violently go after it. Young people, a lot of us, through situations we've been through, our peace has been taken. A lot of us as young people, through situations and relationships, we've given up certain things. And in our minds, it's a struggle to think of that thing which has been taken or that we've given up as ours. But no, 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 no. And the word of God said, I gave you dominion and power to tread upon serpents, to tread on scorpions. That's what the word of God says. So what am I saying? In order to take back your city, in order to take back your school, you must first take back your identity. How do you do that? You get in the word of God. God, who did you say I am? Who do you say I am? What happened with Adam and Eve? They gave up their identity. They gave up their identity. And then what did Adam do? He looked at the woman who had nothing to do with him giving what he gave up, but trying to point blame. Who are you blaming for what you gave up? No, 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 don't blame the guy you slept with. Don't blame the girl you slept with. Don't blame them. Look at you. And don't even blame yourself. Go to God and say, God, this is what has happened. I feel like I don't have what I used to have. Restore me. Another thing, everybody knows that story about Samson. Man who was given much strength. Much strength. But he laid his head down. See, over the years, the story has been kind of finagled, and you hear over here people say, oh, he had sex with Delilah, and then she cut it. No, he laid his head down. He fell asleep. And because his position was one of not being aware of comfort, he positioned himself to be taken from. Young people, there are a lot of us who have positioned ourselves to be taken from. There are a lot of people in your life who are on assignment to take from you. And if you don't have, here's what a relationship with God grants you. Discernment of who and what is in your life taken from you. Discernment. Anybody ever had that moment where you just looked at somebody and was like, where did you come from? You always asking for something. A ride? Money? Gone? You always in a position of taking. How many people have ever done? See, here's the thing. Those people kind of latch on to people who they know are in their DNA have been, you've been built to give. You've been built to give. See, here's the thing. Can't allow anyone to take away from you how God originally made you. You get tired of people taking, so you no longer want to be who you are as a giver. So you indulge in other identities. And you ain't really heartless, you ain't really selfish, but because you want to spare yourself pain of being taken advantage of, you won't give no more. But see, God made you as a giver because you're fulfilled in giving. God is a giver, the ultimate giver. Jesus, those are traits of God. I'm here tonight to tell you, again, when you get in the Word and you go before God and say, God, show me who you made me to be. Don't get so stuck in who you are or who you think you are at the moment, young people. Because who you even think you are may be totally opposite to the person God made you to be. But see, we don't want to always be who God called us to be, because with that identity comes process. And we want to avoid process. We are a want it now, right now type generation. You can't have me at McDonald's waiting more than 5 minutes. Especially if I ordered 2 minute fries. It don't take 5 minutes to make 2 minute fries. I want it now. Give it to me now. Mom, it's time to go. Now. After school, I'm ready to get picked up. Now. After church, y'all, everybody got pickups that like to talk to their friends? I'm ready to go. Now. I'm hungry. Now. Let's go. Now. But see, we've trained ourselves like that. So when it comes to the things of God or the will of God, because for some of us, God will show us the great plan or bits and pieces, and we want to get there like right now. But God's like, well, you can't hit. If I put you there, it would crush you, because you've yet to realize who you are. I was talking to Pastor Mike before we came out. He said, you know, I've been talking to my students about just redefining what success is. And for sure, to me, what I believe he was saying was, success is not defined in how much you obtain over your lifespan. Success is defined in your fulfillment of the will of God for your life. How well you fulfill it. Do you stop when it gets hard, or do you keep going? How well and how on purpose you use the power that he gave you. That's true success. Redefining success. Again, young people, once you take the power God has given you to say yay or nay to what is the headliner of our society, then that's when Jesus comes and takes his place. I'm telling you, if you share Jesus as much as you do anything else on Facebook, Facebook would be very liberating for some people. If you share with people everything you got in church, and you just went to school and shared it with somebody, within a week your school would turn. They may say you can't pray, but no. Here's what happens. The violent take it by force. This is what it looks like. Okay, they say we can't pray in school. No. Because if two girls can walk down the hallway holding hands and kissing, I should be able to pray in school. If two boys can walk down the hall holding hands, I should be able to pray in school. If people can skip and smoke in the bathroom, I should be able to pray in school. If a teacher can cuss and do all that, I should be able to pray in school. The violent taking what they know is theirs by force. You can't take from me what I know is mine. And I won't give you anything that I know is valuable. See, you have to see Jesus and what he called you to be as valuable. If you had a winning lottery ticket and it was $400 million, you wouldn't give it up. Because the value is clearly seen of that ticket. When you see yourself as beautifully and wonderfully made, like Jesus said you are, then you say, nah, bruh, I'm not easily giving this up. See, there's a price that was paid for this, you know what I'm saying? And that price was paid with blood. So I know your blood ain't clean enough, but you're gonna have to spend some time before you get access. And even when you spend time, you're gonna have to do some other things. You're gonna have to spend some money. See, Jesus is the rock of my salvation. I need the rock of my commitment. Fellas, when you see how valuable you are, you won't even give yourself to just anything that's walking. And you won't allow just anything to walk with you. Because a man is also defined as the woman that's beside him. And when you see yourself as a man of God, as a king, as somebody who leads, somebody who follows the leadership of God, somebody that has something to give, somebody that will break the cycle of leaving but creating things and leaving, somebody that will break the cycle of stereotypes and statistics, when you see yourself as that, when you see yourself as valuable, you won't just give yourself up. Okay, Chloe, but what about those who have? I'm here to tell you, God is the restorer of everything. If God can raise the dead, he can restore your virginity. Because here's the thing, ladies, you may say, well, I messed up. I had sex. I lost my virginity to the one I thought was the one. But turned out, yeah, he turned out to be the one that caused me hell. But I feel bad because I lost my virginity to someone who didn't care about me. Isn't it so amazing that God didn't place the purity of who you are or the value of who you are in the physicalities of who you are? See, if your virtue was attached to your virginity, then God wouldn't have even made a scripture as to who can find a virtuous woman. Your virtue is attached to him. Your virtue, your precious you, because of him. In the moment you decide to say, you know what? This body is the temple. It's precious. It's valuable to God. I'm not easily giving this up, and I'm not giving it up. Just anything. That's the moment where restoration happens. And I know we go through things. Trust me, I know. But I'm here to tell you today, Anchor, before we get out of here, because I know my time is not coming down, but I'm here to tell you, this is the generation that will take back this world. The Word of God says, the earth waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. I want you to understand, there was an original you before the you that was born into sin. My mission tonight is saying, take back your original blueprint. See, the Word does say we were all born sin and shaped in iniquity. We were born into those things. Original blueprint was one of dominion and power. Take it back. It's yours. And here's the thing. Here's where grace comes in. It has nothing to do with you. A lot of times we don't even want to touch what we've given up, or if we want to touch what God has given us, because we think we are just not worth it and worthy. Let me tell you something. You're not. But it shows how much he loves you. It shows how much his grace is for you to say, you know what? I'm not basing what I give to you on what you give to me. I'm basing it on my love. What I give to you has nothing to do with how well of a Christian you can be. It has nothing to do with how loud you can pray. It has nothing to do with how long you can go without smoking weed. Because a lot of times we do those things and base what God gives us on what we do. And I'm going to tell you the truth. There was a time where I was like not living the Christian life, and I felt like I lost my salvation. I'm I'm just being real tonight. Anybody ever felt like that? I felt like I lost it. I felt like, you know, I mean, God used to be tight, but I ain't doing what, I ain't living this Christian life, so I feel like I lost it. And God said, you know what? The gifts are without repentance. If I give it to you, I give it to you. I give you salvation, it's yours. I sent Jesus for you, for you. So while I'm sitting here tonight, young people, stand to your feet, reposition yourself. Here's what happens. The first act, you have to reposition yourself. You can't say I'm taking something back, but you in the same position. How can you say I'm taking my peace back, but I won't ever raise my hands and stand up to get it back? Close your eyes. And I want you to get in your mind that thing or those things that you feel you have either given up or that have been taken from you. And I want you to see yourself getting those things back. Why? Because they belong to you. Peace is yours. Joy is yours. Prosperity is yours. Health is yours. These are all the things that Jesus died to give you. They belong to you through Christ Jesus. Through Christ Jesus. And if there's anyone in this room that says, you know what, I don't have Jesus, we can fix that tonight. Because once you get Jesus, you get access to your peace. You get access to your joy. You get access to your prosperity. You get access to everything that He created for you to have in the first place. Just keep that on your mind. Close your eyes, keep it on your mind. See yourself violently take back. Without hesitation, without fear. Can't nobody tell you nothing different. If you say it ain't mine, I tell you, you a lie.
Listen, this is an opportunity. I know this isn't in the program, but salvation is always in God's program. Just because you sing and you dance and you look good don't mean you're saved. Just because you show up to church every Sunday don't mean you're saved. Just because you're the pastor's daughter or the deacon's daughter or the pastor's son or the deacon's son don't mean you're saved. The man of God spoke to you today. This is your generation. I was sharing with him, I said, GLO, we've been talking about redefining success in our youth ministry. I said, what I realize is that our children are like Gideon in the wine press, hiding from the enemy because they don't know who they are. See, in the book of Joshua 1 and 8, it talks about the good success that God has for us, what He thinks about us. Yeah. And then it's amazing, you go just a few chapters down and the people are lost. So you go from going into the promised land to being lost and not knowing who God is. But you know what? The beautiful thing is, your generation, you're still writing your story. You're still writing your story. And you know what? Because you're still writing your story, you have the ability to write whatever ending you want. Oh, that should be a hand clap of praise right there. Listen. I tell my babies this all the time. you have to stop being selfish in order for God to use you. You know how y'all walk around, y'all generation, y'all love to take selfies and post them. Come on, bro, let's take a selfie. Bam! And it seemed like such a little thing. It's amazing how Satan takes just a little thing and pervert it. See, it used to be when children were two years old, they go through a stage where they say, me, me, me. Mine, mine, mine. You know, you put something in one hand and they want something in the other. That's mine, you know. But it's a shame to be 15 and 16 years old still acting like a two-year-old. See, this platform that God created for young people to come together like this, it's not about us. It's not about my generation. We've written our story. We're at the end of our story. People like me and Brother Tracy, we at the end of our story. When I see y'all and I see my babies growing and moving to the next stage, it brings tears to my eyes. See, I got weak in my heart. When I see my grandbaby, I just melt. It don't matter. He can kick the door down. He can throw my favorite glass on the floor and it break. God has humbled me and allowed life to humble me so much. I'm just glad to be here. Listen, young people, you are the most talented and you are the most gifted generation of young people yet. You are. Clap, clap. That's something to clap for. But I don't want you to miss the mark because of that. See, the word talks about something called a good success. Say good success. Say good success. Yeah, the word talks about a good success. And see, if you have any common sense, you know if there's a good success, there has to be a what? Every success ain't a good one. You may not want to pay the price it costs to ride that Mercedes Benz you think you want. Or that five-bedroom house with four bathrooms that you think you want. See, some people have that stuff and they can't go to sleep at night, GLO. I was looking at my son showed me a picture of a guy who we associated with. He was on the news. Oh man, flossing. Had everything money could buy. Everything. Living good. Over when the man came to put the shackles on his feet. Is it worth it? Is it worth it? Is it really worth it? Glo alluded to it earlier. The only good success is when you're doing what God has called you to do. If God called you to sleep in a car like Tyler Perry so you can write great Christian plays. See, you might have been complaining the whole time you were sleeping in that car, but you didn't know that God was giving you a makeover so that you can have a heart for people. So that you can tell Hollywood no unless I can write it the way I want to write it. I don't want to keep you, but it's somebody out there that need to be prayed for. We just want to lead you to Christ. It's a simple prayer. It's nothing fancy. You don't have to be worthy. I wasn't worthy. You don't have to be clean. Only sick people go to a doctor. If you got it all together, you don't need God. We just want to pray for you. Can we pray for you? Is there somebody out there that we can pray for? Is there somebody who wants to be led to Christ? Don't worry about who's next to you. I know they think they're supposed to be saved. Everybody that hop up in the choir ain't saved just because they sang it. Don't worry about your peers. It's okay. This is a place for somebody to lay hands on you. We want the children to pray for you. You can come forward. Maybe you're going through something in your life at school. And you need somebody to pray for you. That's what we're here for. You can give her a hand clap of praise. Come on, we want to pray for you. It's all right. Give that young man a hand clap of praise. See, the devil don't want you to move. He wants you to stay still. He wants you to be embarrassed. Let me share this. I was 27 years old when I got saved for real. My wife can attest to it. I was in Okinawa, Japan. And we were in this multicultural church, you know, with all kind of people. And they didn't have a good choir, you know, when they sing. I used to sit out there, me and my wife, we'd be laughing on the inside so hard, tears be coming out of our eyes. And one day that little preacher said something, and he gave an invitation to come to the front, and I don't even know how I got there, but I just remember tears streaming down my eyes. 27 years old, who goes halfway around the world to a country where less than 1% of the people are saved to get saved? He's everywhere. David said, if I make my bed in hell, he's there. It don't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've been through. Our heads bowed, our eyes closed. Father, you've been so good to us. Lord, we don't deserve you. We know that. But we thank you, Lord, that in spite of our insufficiencies, Lord God, in spite of us falling short on a daily basis, Father, you still love us.